So let's talk about submitting a job on the Biowulf cluster. Most jobs, almost all jobs, should be run in the batch through the batch system. They should be run as batch jobs. There are two ways to submit batch jobs. Sbatch, which is the built-in slurm way to submit jobs, and Swarm, which is an NIH-developed way to submit large numbers of independent jobs. We'll talk about Swarm in a later session, and in this session, we're going to focus on Sbatch. When you submit a job, your default allocation for that job is one physical core on a node, that is two CPUs in the slurm notation. The default memory per CPU is 2 GB, and therefore, the default memory allocation for a job is 4 GB. And both these, the number of CPUs or the number of nodes and the memory allocation can be modified when you submit the job. Let's create a very simple batch script and submit it to the batch system, just so that we get a sense of how this all works. So here I am logged into Biowulf. I'm in a directory called test. And I'm going to use the editor nano to create a batch job script. It's going to be called test.sh. It starts with the usual /bin bash, meaning this is a bash shell script, and it contains only the date command. As you see, /bin bash and the date command. If I type, this is a bash shell script, so I can run it on the command line and by typing sh test.sh, and it prints out the date just as you'd expect. But I can also submit this batch script to the batch system. If I type sbatch to submit it to the batch system, test.sh, you'll see that instead of printing out the date, what it prints out is a string of numbers. And this is the job ID of the batch job that got submitted to the batch system. If I type an ls, you see that there's no output produced. And I can type sq-u, either your username or $user. And it'll show you this job sitting in the queue with the state pd, meaning it's waiting to be run, pending, in the batch queue. A few seconds later, if I type sq-u and your username, you see there's no job in the queue. That's because this job ran and it ran really fast. If I do an ls in the directory, there's a new file in here called slurm_thejobid.out. And if I do more on that file, you see it contains the date. And that's the output from the script. The output that would normally have come to your terminal if you ran it on the command line goes into this file called slurm.out. Here's a slightly more complicated batch script. It starts with /bin bash, meaning it's a bash script, and then it has a set of comments. This comment is, this file is myjob.sh. And as you see, two of the comments start with /sbatch. And those are specific directives to the batch system, so that these comment lines are interpreted differently by the batch system, and they have meaning to the slurm batch system. One line says /sbatch --job name my job. So it's specifying the name of this job. The second line says /sbatch --mail type begin, end, which means send me mail at the beginning of this job, when the job actually starts up on a node, and at the end of the job. And there are other such directives which we'll talk about later in the class. And then the only non-comment line is myprog-n100, and it's reading some file called infile. And myprog is the program that's being run. This is some kind of input parameters. When you submit this job with sbatch /myjob.sh, just as we did earlier, it gives you a job ID. And here's a few important things to know about this batch submission process. Sbatch exports your cell environment to the batch job. That means any environment variables that you have set when you submit the job get exported to the shell in which that job is run. Other command line options can also be used as directives within the script, like /sbatch, as we showed you here. And if you're reporting any problems to our staff about a job that's having some kind of issues, then it's really useful if you send us the job ID, because that lets us look it up and look up some information about the job, and it'll probably help us to debug the process a lot faster. What happens to the standard output and standard error from commands that are run within a batch job? If you type those same commands into a terminal window on the Biowulf login node, then the standard output and standard error would appear in your terminal window. But when a batch job runs on a compute node, there is no terminal window. In that case, the standard out and standard error is combined into a single file called slurm hyphen and the job ID.out, and it appears in your submission directory by default. That's the directory from which you submitted the batch job. And you can send the standard out and standard error to different directories and files by using --error, some path, some file name, or --output, some path, and some file name when you submit the batch job. You probably want to use environment modules in your batch script because you probably want to run some kind of applications. And you would do that exactly as you used modules earlier. In your batch script, you would type module load and the application that you want to load, or module load and application and some version number. And here's some more information about slurm commands that are going to be useful when you submit batch jobs. So the squeue command that we ran a couple of times when we submitted the date script gives you information about jobs, the status, and where the job is running. Scancel is really important because it's the only way to delete a job. Sacket might be useful. It contains job accounting for completed jobs. And so, for example, it'll give you a list of jobs that you submitted today. And then there's the sjobs utility, which is an in-house utility for Biowulf, developed on Biowulf, and it gives you information about running and pending jobs. It's more informative by default than squeue, but it can be slow. Beyond this, you can also create your own squeue commands. There are a lot of options to squeue, and you can create an alias that includes just the options that you're interested in. And here's an important note. Do not run squeue, sacket, or sjobs, in fact, any slurm commands, under watch. Watch is a Unix utility which lets you run the same command over and over again with some specified interval. So sometimes people use watch with a 1 second time interval for squeue because they want to know when their job started up. But this puts a huge load on the batch system. So if you're using watch and any slurm command, you should set a time interval of no less than 2 minutes, 120 seconds. Here's a little more information about deleting batch jobs. You use the scancel command, as I said earlier, and you provide the job ID of the job that you want to delete from the batch system. You can give it a string of job IDs on the same command line. And there are a few options, like you can say --user equals your username, and then it'll cancel all jobs, either pending or running, that belong to you. You can say --name and some job ID, some job name, and it'll cancel all jobs belonging to you with that name. Or --state. If you want to delete only your pending jobs but leave your running jobs still in the batch system, then you can say dash dash state equals PD for pending. Here's an example of deleting a batch job. I can say sbatch test.sh job and sq-u $user will show me that the job is in pending state. So if I type scancel and the job ID, that job is now gone from the batch system. I could also have typed scancel-u $user, or in this case my username is teacher, and it would have had the same effect. It would delete any jobs belonging to me. Or in this case, if I had a whole bunch of jobs called test.sh for some reason, I could have typed scancel-n test.sh and it would have deleted all jobs called test.sh belonging to me. It's important to know that you cannot delete another user's jobs, so it's a really safe command. If you get the job ID wrong, then don't worry, because you can only delete your own jobs. You cannot have deleted someone else's jobs. I showed you earlier that you could set some batch system parameters within the batch script using sbatch, pound sbatch in the batch script. You can also set those same parameters on the command line when you submit the job. So you can say sbatch dash dash job name equals some name, for example, and that's a command line parameter. You can also set an environment variable, sbatch underscore job name, and give it a name. Or as I said before, you can submit it, you can include it in the batch script. If for some reason you do all of these things, you include the same parameter on the command line and in an environment variable and within the batch script, then your command line parameter takes precedence over your environment variable, which takes precedence over your batch script directive. So here's something about how you submit the simplest possible kind of job, a single-threaded application. It requires only one CPU. So your application requires one CPU and less than 4 gigabytes of memory. Remember, 4 gigs is the default. You would simply type sbatch job script, just as we did with the date script. Your allocation would be 2 CPUs, because the default allocation is 1 physical core, that is 2 CPUs, and it would allocate you 4 gigs of memory. If you needed more than 4 gigs of memory, say some number m, you would say sbatch dash dash mem equals some amount of memory with the g for gigabytes and the name of the job script. And you'd get allocated the same 2 CPUs and 4 gigs of memory. It's important to know that job script, the name of your job script, must always be the last parameter on your sbatch command line. Anything included after the job script name is assumed to be parameters that you're passing to the script.